with David and Rick playing from a guitar for us. You can see them from each of the doors of service. And so I just wanted to make sure we all take our seats and listen, because this is good stuff. And welcome. Good morning.
Thank you.
begin, please turn off any electronic devices you have with you. And I invite you to enjoy the chapel that's in the back of the sanctuary. It's had a makeover thanks to Paula Hummauer. And so it's looking really beautiful. And please do check it out. There's a Joys and Concerns book back there that you can let our minister, Reverend Patty Willis, know what's happening with you and your family. She is on her summer sabbatical break for just the month of July. And let's see, we have a nursery downstairs if you have little ones with you. After the service downstairs is a hospitality with coffee and beverages, things to snack on, and people to meet and greet. That is always a joy and fun to be after the service. And then we do have announcements at the Lord's service that are just many ways to get involved in this really vibrant community, and so please do take a chance to meet those as well.
Good morning. My name is Ann Scarborough, and I'm a member of the board here at South Valley, serving as vice president. We are a covenantal rather than a creedal church. This means, from the pulpit, we want words spoken personally and sincerely, but we have no required beliefs or creeds. Instead, using our seven principles to guide us, members covenant with each other, mutual support. So in the same spirit, I give our traditional Sunday service to all who enter here. Come, come, whoever you are welcome here. No matter your age, your size, the color of your eyes, your hair, your skin, you are welcome here. No matter whom you love, how you speak, or whatever your abilities, you are welcome here. You are welcome here, whether you come with laughter in your heart or tears. You are welcome here. Not just your willing hands, your loving heart, or your open mind, but you, the complete you, exactly as you are. You are welcome here. Please join us in singing the opening song. Hold on, sorry.
We're going to do opening words right now, and we're going to start with a poem by Mary Oliver. She's kind of our unofficial poet laureate for Unitarians. This one's The Summer Day. Who made the world? Who made the swan and the black bear? Who made the grasshopper? This grasshopper, I mean. The one who has flung herself out of the grass, the one who is eating sugar out of my hand, who is moving her jaws back and forth instead of up and down, who's gazing around with her enormous and complicated eyes. Now she lifts her pale forearms and thoroughly washes her face. Now she snaps her wings open and floats away. I don't know exactly what a prayer is. I do know how to pay attention. How to fall down into the grass, how to kneel down in the grass, how to be idle and rest, how to stroll through the fields, which is what I've been doing all day. Tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? Tell me, what is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Paying attention. What else should we do but pay attention to this beautiful world on lovely summer morning like this, or any morning for that matter. I'm going to introduce, as I have up here, I'm going to introduce the two guests that we have today. And first of all, my friend Sue. Sue Smith. Yay, Sue! People know Sue. She was the punk rocker at our 80s event last fall, if you can imagine. Hair straight up and a motorcycle jacket that really was yours. The boots and everything. And she bought some things there and went to various events, so you've come and met her through time. Sue pays attention. She has an amazing ability to look directly at events and humans, both at our best and worst, tease out strengths and underlying connections in a way that helps me center what she's around. Over the last couple of years, we've talked a bit about her beliefs, including those stemming from Eckankar, a a religion she joined in the 70s, fairly soon after it began. We find similarities and differences as we discuss UUism and Eckankar, and both Reverend Patty and I wanted her to speak to you today as we hear during this month of July individual spiritual journeys. So I'm going to give you her bio now. Sue Smith joined Eckankar in 1976, is currently the lead cleric in Utah, but that's actually regional, isn't it? Oh, regions Utah, okay. her official title is RESA, which is Regional X Spiritual Aid, of which there's less than 100 of you worldwide. She's now retired from Intermountain Healthcare, Select Health, here in Utah, after a career which included teaching elementary school, working her way up through management of a corporate 500 company. So, okay, she's helped start IBM. Okay. Major. And she worked at a healthcare manufacturing company, received her master's in training technologies, which allowed her to finish her career as a corporate trainer. Grew up in Michigan, so we're both from the Midwest and share that. And has lived in Maryland, Virginia, Texas, New Mexico, and now here. At 60 years old, she decided to work on her bucket list, which included taking up drawing and painting, and so I brought gifts that she's given us of her paintings today, and they're on the altar. You want to come up after and look closer. She loves to travel, bicycle, swim, and hike. Since she moved to Utah in 2007, she's had many opportunities to pursue those interests and formed great and lasting friendships. Thanks for being here, Jason. We also have today with us Jessica Rodman, first, Jessica. Oh, there. With the Crossroads Urban Center. Who will be talking to us about the emergency food pantry and other ways Crossroads takes care of our community, because we're sharing our offerings during July and August with this organization. Jessica, or Jess, is the community outreach coordinator at Crossroads, and moved to Salt Lake a couple years ago in San Diego to pursue a graduate degree in community leadership from Westminster College, which she has done within 2 weeks. Awesome. She also has a background in public and community service studies and theology from Providence College. She worked for 5 years in advocacy for and direct service to low-income individuals and a nutritionist at California Women, Infants, and Children before she came to Utah. Crossroads celebrated its 50th year of serving Utah in January this January. That's amazing. 50 years of service from this organization. She put on a gospel extravaganza to celebrate it. Yeah. And then also this spring, I saw that I missed the Beer, Blues, and Brats fundraiser. And this fall, there's a wine and cheese fundraiser, yeah. So these are our people, you guys. We love to party. So we need to party with Crossroads Urban Center. Okay. all right. Yeah, so now you know who's going to talk to you later. Let's rise as you're willing and able and sing together that song that Anne was suggesting, 347, Gather the Spirit. Our board president, Jan, will lead us.
Thank you. standing for the chalice lighting.
I've invited Evelyn and Amy Jensen to help me light our chalice.
Alina and her wife will transform that social hall downstairs. upstairs. They were hacking up the walls and the ceilings and making a difference. So they jumped right in. Thanks for all you do. Thanks, Lauren. Now we have story time with Jess from Crossroads, and she's going to do a really cool one. So, young and young at heart. Liz always wants us to find the young at heart as well. So anyone can come up close to be able to see what's going to happen with the story today. So come on up, kids, and then anyone young at heart.
Thank you. about even. Everyone gets a little bit. That's fair. That's fair. But what it really looks like is this. That still looks pretty even, right? About a little more. Then 22% get about 34%. A little more than their fair share, but not too bad. Us in the US, 6% of the world's population consumes 40% of the world's food. That's not really very fair, is it? And we don't always eat all of it either. Think of how many times we have extra food on our plate and we just throw it in the trash or we see someone throw it in the trash. There are a lot of complex reasons that this exists, lots of reasons. But the reality is, no matter how you look at these cups, the marbles aren't fair, are they? And this model represents the whole world, but the same is true right here in the United States. Can anyone tell me what this is a map of? The United States? Good job, another notch. So what do you notice about this map, about the color? Good, so there are different colors. So it's actually the opposite. So the dark places are where people not only don't always have extra on their plate, they don't even always know if they're going to have another plate of food in the day. Even more true, can anyone tell me what this is a map of? Plus, it's part of the USA. What part is it, do you think? Utah, yeah. So we see a map of Utah. Notice there's the same color difference. Right? There's still some dark green and still some light green. And in Utah, every 1 in 3 child is hungry. So 1 in 3 of the people you know, all that if you have a group of 3 people, one person is statistically likely to be hungry, one child. So we try and do at our food pantry is we try and redistribute the food. And what your amazing community is going to do for us for the next 2 months, is all year, but especially in the next 2 months, is to help us make sure that the people in these cups get their fair share of the food here in Utah. So I want to thank you so much for being part of it. You guys contribute to it too by being here. And lastly, I just want to show you a picture of one of our beneficiaries. Can anyone tell me what that is? Koala. Yeah. I don't actually know what kind. So it's a picture of this cute little dog. So we serve humans in our food pantry. That's what the donations go for. But if you have pets, you know that your furry friends are part of your family too, aren't they? So we also try and make sure they get fed in different ways. Plus, he was just too cute not to share. It's our cutest beneficiary. So thank you so much for helping us this summer and for being here and listening.
Grassroots organization that advocates for Utahns with low incomes, those with disabilities, and people of color to meet basic survival needs and improve their quality of life. You guys are opening a second emergency food pantry this fall in the Poplar Grove neighborhood, which is currently a food desert. So thank you, Jess, for being on this and telling us more about what you do. Please do give generously. And let us say together the words of others of service for our offering. We are the church. We are its hands, its heart, its voice. Together we share the wealth of this community and sustain it through our gifts.
Thank you.
Can you bring him? Hello.
Again.
I've been here many times, you know, for the good stuff. The music, listening to other speakers from other groups, organizations, and religions, and April 9th. So I've always had a lot of fun here. The one time I don't come here is Sunday service, and that's because, as Brenda explained, I actually belong to a different church. And more than that, I'm actually a clergy at a different church. But I always feel so welcome here, so I speak over here anyway. The other church is called Eckankar, and we refer to it as the path of spiritual freedom. And as I kind of look through your order of service today and some of the things I want to share, I saw that there were so many similarities. No wonder I feel so welcome here each time I come and so comfortable. So I really appreciate that. Eckankar actually was brought to the modern day in 1965 by Paul Twitchell. And for those of you who may have heard stories, or maybe you lived back then, you know it was an interesting time, wasn't it? It was a time of, well, people saying enough is enough. And we find ourselves there again. 1965, we're in the middle of the Vietnam War. We were, racial situation was intolerable. Gender equality was something to fight for. We had so many things going on, and it was really close to home. Well, this wasn't just in the USA, but this was everywhere. This was in South Africa, Europe, and Asia, which was affected by the Vietnam War. So there was a lot of turmoil. It was ripe for people to say, enough is enough with the status quo. It's time to look at something else. And Eckankar was born in that time. It is an ancient teaching that just got brought forth in modern times. One of the key principles, I keep thinking I'm hearing that. Am I
just starting
out there? I kind of don't, because I need to walk. Okay, I'll try this. I'm trying to think where I was. Oh, yes. So one of the key principles, what you all talk about is in Eckankar we believe that we are all spiritual beings and become in all forms. We happen to be spiritual beings right now in the human form. That's who we are in our physical bodies. We have to take care of those. It's kind of a harsh planet that we live on. And so we're in these physical forms, and I don't know about you, but I think the physical body is kind of whining, really. I mean, it's always like complaining, isn't it? I'm hungry. I'm tired. I need sleep. I'm cold. I'm hot. I need romance. I mean, the thing is very demanding. And then we also have our emotional side to ourselves, equally as demanding. I'm happy. I'm sad. I'm bored. Be me. I gotta be creative. I need romance. But we give a lot of credit to our mental side. We say, oh, that's the smart one. That'll keep us going. And if you think about it, we say in Eckankar that the mind is a great tool, not such a great master. And so to demonstrate this, I'm going to ask you to think about anything you want to think about. But the one thing I don't want you to think about or imagine is a red wagon. Okay. Really? So how many of you had your mind go, here's the red wagon you're not supposed to be thinking about? So if we can get in touch with our core, our spiritual being, and that is who we are, that gives us a lot more leverage in this on this very tough assignment of Earth that we live on. It also helps us see the fabric, the fact that we are all connected. And just as I heard this morning how your basic beliefs are that we are all these beings. I was looking at your set of principles, and I really don't think I can describe what I'm trying to say better than what you have here, where you say that you have respect for the interdependent web of all existence, of
of which we are all a part. I couldn't say it any better than what you have right there. The other core belief that we have is in Eckankar is we do believe in reincarnation and we do believe in karma. We don't believe in hell, we don't believe in sin. We believe life is an adventure. We learn by our mistakes as well as our successes. And we just keep growing and learning and being better at who we are and taking care of these bodies that we have to take care of. So in the course of the experiences, we also find out that these experiences start anytime. They don't necessarily start when you become at the age of reason at 7, or at a bar mitzvah at 13, or at 21 when you become the drinking age. These experiences can start anytime. So for me, I want to share an experience I had growing up and what kind of led me to a path such as Eckankar. I have to say that I really don't remember a time when I don't remember having a connection or an awareness of something beyond me, something a part of me. I don't really know if it was a guardian angel or protector or comforter or God or Jesus. I don't really know what it was. I was just very, very aware of it all along. And by the time I was 7 years old, our family was going through a pretty rough patch. And one night, my mother said to me that, and my brother and sister, I was the eldest, that we weren't going to be able to stay with her anymore. That we were going to have to go to a boarding farm. So I was pretty devastated. I didn't say anything or cry or anything. I just took the news. But I did feel this sort of choking feeling. When I went to bed that night, I remember sitting up in bed and trying not to fall asleep, afraid this choking feeling would overtake me. So the next memory I have is standing in the kitchen. Well, actually, the next memory I have is someone tugging at my sleeve. And I found myself standing in a farm kitchen. Farm lady was there, my mother was there, my brother was off playing, and my sister was in a high chair. And I looked around, and a young girl, probably 9 or 10, said, do you want to go see the cows? I have no idea how much time it took between hearing the news that we were going to make this move and that moment. But I do know I came back from a very far away place, I guess. And everybody nodded, said, yeah, go see the cows. So I followed her out the farmhouse, across the dirt road over to the barn where there was a corral. And I'd seen cows before, so I lived in Michigan in the country, and I didn't know they were that big till we got up close. I was amazed. So Darlene, the girl, hopped up on the bottom rail of the fence, and I hopped up next to her, and she put her hand out and put her hand on the head of the cow, and I put my hand out also, just kind of reached on the back between the shoulders, and in that moment, I just felt so connected. I just felt like everything was going to be okay, strength and warmth and solidness of that cow. And then the inner dialogue that I'd always had started up again. And I started to do a self-assessment. I said, well, you know, I know how to brush my teeth. I know how to go to school. I know how to help my brother get dressed. I think I can do this. But then I asked this inner whatever, well, but who's going to teach me? And it said, just remember these four things. Tell the truth, try not to hurt anyone, do your best work, and be on time. And I thought, yeah, I can do that. I said, but who's going to teach me the rest? I said, don't worry, when you're ready, I'll send the others. So I was fine. I looked around and said, yeah, I think I can do this. Besides, they have cows here. I never petted a cow before. So I was pretty confident. And I felt pretty free. I mean, then, 7 years old, kind of on your own, you got to know how to do stuff. I soon learned quickly, though, that with this new spiritual freedom comes responsibility. It would happen that very next Sunday. So I was told by the farm lady that we were going to go to church. I was thrilled. I'd never been in church before. And I figured this is where whatever was talking to me must live. The Christmas before, my father had sent me a Bible. It was a beautiful Bible. It had white cover, gold print, gold on the edges of the paper. I just loved it. So, grabbed my Bible, off to church we went. And I remember walking up the sidewalk, quite confident, getting ready to go to church when this old gray-haired guy, well, sorry, but at the time I was only 7. So he stops and he says, well, where are you going? suppose if I knew the word obvious, I would say that. I didn't. So I said, well, I'm going into churches. Children don't go to church. They go to Sunday school. Yeah, but I'm here to see God, and he's in this church. So, no. Well, before I knew it, he had someone take me over to the building next door, and in his Sunday school I went. I walk into Sunday school, and I see that there's a circle of kids sitting around. And so I sat down with them, and I looked around, and they all had Bibles. The Bibles had black numbers. So Sunday school teacher wasn't there, so I figured I would show them what a real Bible looked like. So I was in the middle showing them the pictures inside my Bible when the Sunday school teacher came in, and she said, well, what are you doing? And I looked at her kind of surprised, and I thought, oh my gosh, she's never seen one either. So I opened it up to begin to show her what a real Bible looked like. And, well, as you might imagine, this didn't really go over very well. So she explained to me how I'd hurt their feelings and I should just sit quiet and listen. So I remember sitting there. And for the first time, I started to feel a little dejected, a little sorry for myself. Mainly because it hadn't even been a week and I wasn't broken one of the rules. So I didn't want to hurt anyone. I'd hurt their feelings. I'm sitting there thinking, gosh, have done that. It's not their fault we don't have a real Bible. Again, I was only seven. I almost had it right. So later that day, there was a phone call at the farmhouse. The word disruptive was used. And I knew at that moment I probably would never go back to church. But before that happened, as I was sitting in the chair in the circle, the Sunday school teacher said, and now remember the Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And my head popped up and says, the Holy Ghost, what's that? She says, well, that's the invisible part of the Spirit. That's the invisible part of God. Well, if people know about it, they must have seen it. So what does it look like? No, it's invisible. You can't see it. And I said, well, if you can hear it, I can hear new voices, right? Then you must be able to see it. I just need to know what it looks like. And so we had a little argument going on. She just never really explained that to me. Just the whole thing ended. Well, that night, I remember sitting in bed and saying, okay, show yourself. I know you're out there. I was so excited. It would be another 17 years before I would learn about Eckankar, which explained what this Holy Ghost was, which to me was this fabric that you all talk about. Okay, so once we get connected and know about this Holy Spirit, how do we stay connected? In Eckankar, we teach meditation and contemplation, which I think you all do as well, right? Meditate, all we do. And one of the things that we add to our meditation is the word hu, H-U. And this is an ancient sound. It's been around for a while. Sometimes we call it the sound behind the sounds. And as we sing the hu, we just sort of allow it to come through us. And it gives us a very centered way of feeling. So we just sing hu. And sometimes we see maybe images inside, or we might see a color, or we might hear a humming sound, or we just have a feeling of well-being. And so I was wondering if you'd like to sing a couple of hymns today. Yeah, try it? Okay, so just get comfortable like you would in your meditation. We'll sing a few hymns, and then to end it, I'll just say, may the blessings be. And that kind of reminds us that this is a non-directed contemplation. We're not really asking for anything. We're just trying to get ourselves centered and be connected with the Spirit. So I'll start you out. You can close your eyes if you want to. Just relax and start to do it.
Thank you.
you shared this sound at the World Parliament when we were there, and we also put up a sign that says, tell us your spiritual experience. We weren't trying to talk about Eckankar, we were trying to get people to share their experiences, like I just shared with you today. We were amazed at how many people shared an experience of protection that was unexplained, or foresight, or just any kind of spiritual experience. And how many, well, we were also amazed at how many people said, you know, I've never shared this with anyone before. I was always afraid they'd think I was crazy, or they wouldn't believe me, or for us, the worst was my church wouldn't accept me because of that. And so it's very, very wonderful to see that there's a place of acceptance, like here, with my path, like Eckankar, which is why I stay with that path. The Hue helps you stay connected. It helps you be more aware of the things that are going on around you. I think earlier today someone said, pay attention. That's exactly what it helps you do. Pay attention to that other part of yourself, that spiritual part of yourself. So I thank you for letting me share today. I really appreciate it. And for letting me come for all the rest of the other folks.
Thank you, Sue. That was awesome. I wanted to keep queuing. We have a closing song, Voices Still and Small, to kind of recognize that we all have that internal voice that helps guide us when we need it. And so, in your great hymnals, please stand as you're laying in the Actually, why don't we just sit? This is kind of a quiet song. Let's sit. We just hear and all that. 391, is that what that says? 391. this, put out the flame, but and everybody can help me do this, but not be. Thank you.